Hi, I thought that seeing as my book is coming out really soon, so that's Beasts Before Us, which is out on the 10th of June, published by Bloomsbury Sigma, that I would give you a little treat and read out some passages, some little excerpts from inside, just to give you a taste, to give you a flavour of the story that's told inside. Now, it's the story of mammal origins and evolution. And I want to start with a little snippet from chapter one, which starts close to home before I take you on a tour around the world. So close to home in this case is the Isle of Skye, and my book is beautifully illustrated by April Neander. And here at the start of every chapter we have an illustration, and here she has illustrated some of the landscapes that those who visited Skye will be well acquainted with. So the chapter is called The Isle of Mists and Lagoons. So my first trip to Skye was swallowed in rain clouds. I was 12 years old, and my family packed themselves into a car and set off for the coast. We lived on the shores of Loch Ness at the time, and the road to Skye led through some of the most impressive mountains in Scotland. None of them were visible, of course, from our subnebular position at the bottom of the ice-carved glens. Now, my parents, they'd made a big fuss about driving over the newly constructed bridge from Cailleachall to Cailleachan, connecting the mainland to the island. They reminisced about the old car ferry, which now only runs for curious locals and, sorry, curious tourists and nostalgic locals, and how different life would be for the inhabitants of the island. This was discussed with both appreciation and regret, as most improvements to transport links in Scotland are. When our tyres hit Skye's tarmac, it was like diving under a wave. The rain didn't fall, it just existed everywhere at once. We saw almost nothing on our day trip except pervasive russet gloom, with a soundtrack of frantically beating windscreen wipers. Dad, a mountaineer, talked about the incredible peaks of the Coolin mountain range, which he swore were right there, just beyond the clouds. I gazed absent-mindedly out of the window at the murk, and that was when I saw it. Perched on a fence by the roadside, a hook-beaked silhouette, reaper of rabbits, giant wings folded like closed stable doors over its oak-brown back. "I saw a golden eagle!" I exclaimed to my parents, pressing my nose to the window. The car had shot past before anybody else could see. Mum asked me if it wasn't just a buzzard, but no, it was an eagle all right, the first I'd ever seen, dwarfing those everyday buzzards. A magnification of raptordom, a regal giant of the bird world. My first dinosaur on the Isle of Skye. 20 years later, I stood on the shoreline of the Trottinish Peninsula in northern Skye with my big green hiking boot in a Jurassic dinosaur's footstep. I was at Rhuannon near Staffan, the most remote dinosaur footprint in the UK, but that is a relative term. To Highlanders, Skye's prints are much less remote than those of the south coast of England. I had walked down to the shore to prospect for fossils with a team from the University of Edinburgh, being shown the way by local fossil expert Dougald Ross. A crofter and builder, Ross grew up in Trotternish, and as we found ourselves drawing level on the slippery mud path, I greeted him in Gaelic, his native tongue, and one that I know shamefully little of for a Highlander. In sparse and gentle island lullabies, he began to share the potted history of his life. Now, as a teenager, Ross had made many archaeological discoveries amongst the forgotten settlements of the island. Arrowheads, once believed to be carved by fairies, pointed to the most ancient settlers of the Inner Hebrides. Inspired by these finds and the rich local heritage, Ross had claimed the ruined walls of an abandoned one-room schoolhouse near his home, and he declared to his father, who was a stonemason, that he would restore it and build the island's first museum. Ross's father scratched his chin and shook his head and left his son to pursue the wild dreams of a young man. But a lifetime later, Dougald Ross's museum is still standing. It's a stone-walled, single-story construction perched by the roadside. Under the slate roof, the inside's a whitewashed stone, and the air leaves a tang of rust on the tip of your tongue. It's filled with a lovingly curated debris of Skye's history. Farm equipment saved from roadside ditches or pulled from the peat. Glass bottles, floral crockery and measuring tools, a rusted mole trap, and fossils, big and small. Since discovering his archaeological treasures, Ross has made many significant Jurassic reptile discoveries on the Isle of Skye. These include fragments of dinosaurs and their cousins, the marine reptiles. He's been published many times along with his friend and collaborator, Neil Clark, curator of the Hunterian Museum in Glasgow. Between them over the last 20 years, Ross and Clark have described individual bones and footprints exposed along the magnificently ruinous shoreline of northern Skye. Latterly, Ross began working with researchers at the University of Edinburgh too, and this is how I met him on that sunny day. As we walked towards Ruinambraran, Ross told me it meant Point of the Brothers. There were two stories behind the name, he said. Either it was named for a monk who had lived there, or it was named for the tragic death of a local fisherman's brother. So which one is it? I asked him. Like many place names, it's hard to separate the literal origins from the poetic. With a whiskery smile, Ross invited me to pick whichever one I liked best. And through some impressive detective work, he has since discovered that Ruinambraran is probably a corruption of Ruinambraran, a quernstone point. Now, querns are the large circular stones that once commonly were used for grinding grain. And the sizeable man-made circular holes in the rock here suggest that it was once the site of an industrial-scale quern removal site. Amateur fossil hunters in Great Britain are well acquainted with the fossil-rich sites of the English coast. In a trend initiated by Victorian naturalists, they walk the shores in search of ammonites, belemnites, and the occasional marine reptile or dinosaur that emerges from the salt-rubbed shores. But here in Scotland, as one might expect, our Jurassic coast is a lot less civilised. You can't amble. It's not a gentle beach stroll. Skye's northern coast drops like a ledge at the end of the earth into the salty Minch, the cold seaway running between the Hebrides and the mainland. At the base of these cliffs, the water batters the sandstone, tearing off chunks of it in winter fury and tossing them along the shore like cabers. The sun was shining and the sea was quite calm as our team hiked to the shore to search among the geological wreckage. This was very different from my work with the main team in the south of Skye. Here in Trotternish, we clambered over the massive sandstone boulders like ants on sugar cubes. Vertebrate fossils are very rare in northern Skye, and most days we come back with nothing but scraped knees and raw wind-whipped cheeks. Along much of the coast, there aren't even the ammonite riches that compensate avid fossil hunters on English shores for their diligent hours. Now, Ross has spent years negotiating these coastlines. And although his finds are significant for the Scottish fossil record and have rightly earned him the Paleontological Association's Mary Anning Award in recognition of his achievements, numerically, they are small compared with the longer established sites in England. But in the same way that centuries of crofters have laboured hard to make their livelihood from the harsh coastal landscape, so the same tough labour searching for fossils here is well worth the reward. It's home, and that makes every find a treasure. Although dinosaur feet stride easily into the headlines, these animals provide only a partial picture of the ecosystems that they inhabited. Imagine trying to understand the grasslands of the Serengeti, but only studying lions or wildebeest. Or looking at a tropical reef and just watching nothing but the sharks. As wonderful as those creatures are, to truly understand an ecosystem and how it functions, we have to investigate the smallest inhabitants because they often play key roles. Like most paleontologists, I began my career thinking that the most exciting creatures were the massive Ice Age megabeasts or the colossal Cretaceous reptiles. I soon realised that the real meat and bones of the past are found in the tiniest of life forms. Mesozoic mammals are one of those pivotal groups. Despite their generally diminutive size during the time of dinosaurs, their evolutionary path is not one of relegation, but innovation. They seized the moment with endothermic gusto, and what's more, as I began my own path into science, I saw that their small size during one phase of prehistory was only a snapshot in a much longer, more complicated story. They were the key players in the birth of modern ecosystems, but they were also the first past the post for novel modes of life long before that. Modes like dedicated herbivory and hypercarnivory. Their family album was massive and it was filled with the most unlikely cousins from a long-lost world. This branch of the tree of life has seen some of the most radical changes of all. Their tale is packed with evolutionary eurekas that would, in one day, produce all the mixed blessings of humankind. And if you'd like to find out more, pre-order or buy my book. It's available from the 10th of June.